name is Sanjay Parikh, and I'm absolutely delighted to have the privilege and pleasure to welcome you all to this event, and a forum which we hope will continue to grow and become one of the more popular as well as more interactive forums for the exchange of ideas and viewpoints around some of the future challenges that our industry is encountering. PharmaFuture was launched as an initiative by Indrajeet a little over 4 years ago, and it was designed to be an interactive forum where senior thought leaders from the industry would come together and would share their ideas and their perspectives on some of the challenges, the trends, the themes that were emerging in pharma, life sciences, healthcare, as well as to share their experiences and insights as to what the industry may do and how they need to prepare to handle some of these changes that were forthcoming. Over the last 4 years, we've had very successful events in India, in the UAE, in China, and in every one of these cases, the response was extremely positive, and that kind of encouraged us to look even beyond. We felt that there was need for a forum like this, and therefore we're really excited to be hosting this event today. This is our first PharmaFuture in North America. And we really think that the success of this forum comes from the fact that we bring together some thought leaders, people who have deep perspectives on some of the challenges in the industry, and talk about things which are current and relevant, and then keep it a little more interactive with free flow of ideas. Our theme for today is negotiating the commercial cliff. And in the ever-changing world of healthcare, we've seen a lot of changes. On one side, there are changes in customer segments, the demographics, as well as the influence that different customers have in the healthcare industry moving forward. Then there's also the penetration of technology, as well as the need to drive global compliance, as well as global efficiency. So, this is combined, if you will, with trends such as personalized medicine, value-based healthcare. Is our industry ready? And are commercial leaders in the industry ready? What are some of the approaches that they are taking to tackle some of the future challenges of this industry? What works? What doesn't work? And that's really, just a subset of some of the ideas we hope to be able to discuss over the course of the next 2.5 to 3 hours. And in order to be able to do that, I think we've been able to get a galaxy of very senior thought leaders from the industry, people who've spent years, internalizing several of the internal dynamics of the industry, as well as looking at the external world, and kind of led the way, if you will, in transforming their companies, as well as, in a larger sense, making transformation changes in the industry itself. We are hoping that they will basically be able to share their ideas in an interactive forum, and I would request all of you to also kind of participate by sharing your views, opinions, as well as raising questions along the way. And we hope that it remains as interactive and free flow as we always hoped that this forum would be. Just before we start, some housekeeping issues. You all please keep your mobile phones on silent mode. I will also request you, and I know that Ruby would kill me if I don't, to request you to spend a few minutes to fill out the surveys that are in front of you whenever you get the time during the course of the afternoon. So without taking up any more time, let me invite our Chief Sales and Marketing Officer, Bob Glaser, to introduce our keynote speaker today. Bob himself is an industry veteran with more than 40 years of experience in the pharma and healthcare industry. And honestly, I can't think of a person more qualified in this room to kick off PharmaFuture 2016. So thank you very much, and I hope you have a wonderful afternoon. Thank you.
Thanks, Sanjay. I guess 40 years just means you're old. But anyways, I'm happy to be here and welcome to all of you today for hopefully what will be an exciting afternoon and hopefully some fun and good conversation this evening if you stick around. I have the privilege really of introducing someone that I've known for over 25 years. We share a lot of experiences together at my time at Merck. We have at least three things in common. We both love airplanes, and Jay will hopefully tell a little story about some news he just heard today. We both wanted to fly in the Air Force when we were younger, but our eyesight precluded that. We both love fast cars and have to drive almost identical cars right now, which is very ironic. And we both really have a true love for this industry and for ethical pharmaceuticals and for the future that they provide for, you know, our family members and our neighbors and everybody, you know, around the world. And so that's what we're going to focus on today, really, is, you know, this negotiating the commercial cliff. You know, Jay's going to talk about the headwinds and the tailwinds going forward with ethical pharmaceuticals and research-based companies. Jay Galeota is, I have to read this because it's much longer than what I knew last time, is the Chief Strategy and Business Development Officer at Merck. He's also President of the Emerging Markets Business. You know, in this role, he helps to shape Merck's long-term strategy. He is leading expertise worldwide with respect to Merck's emerging growth fund. And he also, you know, does a lot of work outside in talking to audiences like this and working very closely with Ken Frazier and the senior executive team in policy issues around the country and around the world. I can't really think of a better person to kick off our keynote today. And so now I'm going to turn it over to Jay, welcome you, and thank you for participating.
Well, thanks a lot, Bob, for that fun and maybe a little embarrassing introduction, the reference to the airplane story. So I guess I might as well get that out of the way right away. And Bob's right. I was Air Force ROTC through school and had dreams of being a fighter pilot, and that didn't work out due to my eyes. So I quickly pivoted and landed at Merck, and fortunately had a biology degree to fall back on. And about 18 months ago, I had a request to, or was offered to, become a civilian appointee as the honorary commander of the Air Wing down at Andrews Air Force Base in Virginia, and that's a fighter wing. And so I thought for about a split second, I'm sure I'll be able to do that, and reconnected with the Air Force all these years later, and I just found on the way here that they just finally got approval for me to go fly with them in the F-16s now, so which I'm really excited about. It's something that I've been dreaming about for years, so I was thrilled to see that. I shared that with Bob this day to tell that story, and I kind of thought about it from two aspects. One is it's pretty reminder that if you stay after stuff, sometimes you can achieve it. And the second thing that's probably more relevant for this group is that, you know, we think pharma moves slow. It took 18 months for the government to approve this thing. So it came through. So anyway, with that, I think for the next 20 minutes or so, I'm really honored to be able to share some perspective. Really, it's an end of one, my point of view, just on the industry, but a result of a lot of work that a lot of folks at our company have done, taking a look at what the landscape for pharma looks like with a simple question. And I see, you know, Mark, Margarita, and Eric, who work in our group, who helped prepare a lot of our thinking on this, are in the room too, so they're great sources of reference. But the real question we were trying to answer in a very basic sense is innovative pharmaceuticals, do innovative pharmaceuticals still make sense in the world of the future? And, you know, we see different types of business models that have emerged around our industry. We see pressure and you know, it's easy to pick up a paper and look at the news and you know, start to question if it makes sense, if there's still a viable future. And so, you know, the question is to be or not to be. Is the goal of discovering composition of matter, new chemical entities that provide therapeutic benefit that the world has never seen before, is that still going to be valued 10 years from now, 20 years from now, the way that it has over the last 20, 25, 30 plus years? And, you know, to be or not to be. And so we'll talk a little bit about some of these points. And you heard Sanjay mention, you know, it's really a story of headwinds and tailwinds. And I think more often than not these days, we hear a lot about the headwinds. And, you know, a few of them here just to illustrate. One headwind, of course, is is around this idea of R&D productivity and R&D expenditure. And you know, depending on what sources you look at, you see the same story. The graphic, and I'll point on the chart over here, if you can see, you know, this just looks at R&D expense in billions of dollars. This is GDP in trillions of dollars. And when you compare the rates of these two lines and you normalize the difference, you don't have to squint too hard to see that the rate of R&D expenses has outpaced consistently, has outpaced GDP growth, which, you know, right away starts to raise questions about efficiency and sustainability. And so, you know, headwind pressure, the marketplace sees that, Wall Street sees that, we read it as the industry sector is challenged to think about ways to do things differently. And then you don't have to look too much further to see another very glaring headwind, particularly in this political climate here in the U.S. right now, around drug pricing. And you see consolidation payers, right, Aetna and Humana coming together, and even consolidation of politicians, which is kind of scary. The one thing that Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton seem to agree on is that drug prices are too high and need to come down. And so a lot of rhetoric, a lot of drum beating around, you know, does our price model make sense? Is it sustainable? And another headwind, again, that you know, help affects us in the commercial side of the business. So R&D side's pressured, the pricing is pressured, but on the commercial side, there's obviously pressure too around regulatory scrutiny. And the first decade of the century really was hallmarked in our industry by a very heightened focus on regulation. And some examples here in the U.S. around transparency and the Sunshine Act, FDA warning letters sent to companies around their commercial behaviors, and even on the drug regulatory front, number of product recalls. And so a tougher regulatory environment, a tougher political environment, and a tougher drug discovery environment. And those forces combined, I think, you know, you don't have to really kind of push too far to start to question, is innovative pharma still a viable long-term business model? Is it still the place to be when you look at where healthcare, you know, where pharmaceuticals play in the bigger picture of healthcare? That said, as you dissect the future and, you know, attempt to kind of segment out pieces of it, it's pretty apparent that there are some counter-pressing tailwinds so unknown to us through technology, through these high-power computers. And to move more rapidly to therapeutic targets. The second is around precision medicine. And precision medicine in a real world, in a real sense, has potential to change the way we do clinical studies, the way we develop products. The ability to understand it across a cohort of patients, which group, which subset of that cohort is most likely to be robust responders, average responders, modest responders, and as importantly, most more likely to have side effect, less likely, et cetera, really allows custom tailoring of trial design to identify specifically populations that can gain the most benefit from these new chemical entities. And then the third is, if you take it one step further, discovery, development, the third is really outcomes in the real world. We all know that as important as our medicines are, they go into humans, and humans are very hard to predict. And behavior has as much influence over outcome as therapeutics do oftentimes. And the ability to influence behavior in concert with the benefit that a therapeutic brings will enhance the likelihood that a patient will achieve the desired outcome, and or a payer, government, et cetera, society will get and derive, will have an opportunity to derive maximum value from our discoveries. So technology at a very rapid pace, playing more and more in a role across our value chain. So, you know, if you go to tally it up, I think it's pretty clear the tailwinds have it. There are headwinds, and in the near term, you can easily be overcome by the headwinds that you read about and hear about all the time. But in the big picture, the tailwinds are clearly a driving force against those headwinds. However, we can't overlook the fact that we are going to have to do some things differently as an industry in the marketplace of the future. We've got these great, exciting, potential underlying dynamics that give us reason to believe innovative pharmaceuticals will always play a role, at least for the foreseeable future. Yet the environment is changing, and some of the things that we talked about illustrate time and again that we need to change too. And we're fairly slow at changing, as I kind of joked about at the beginning, as an industry, in a lot of ways, we look very similar to the way we looked 25, 30 years ago when Bob and I were working together and the industry was in its prime then. And so I want to talk, kind of switch now and talk a little bit more for the rest of the talk about some of those areas that I think are ripe for change. And they're really seven, kind of characterize it to seven. And that's a lot to remember. You know, I would have liked to boil it down to three, but part of the reason we, you know, wanted to leave it at seven is we've got two really strong panels to come up and talk after I'm done. And I wanted to make sure we had enough, there was enough kind of thought-provoking stuff out there at the beginning to really drive the panels around. And so the first area, to me, has to do with IT and transforming the way we think about IT as an industry. And all of our companies, I'm sure, have different models for how we use IT, but in a lot of ways, there's a traditional moniker that we call IT that really isn't a unified function. When you think about the role that IT needs to play and will play across the different steps of the value chain, and this just shows, you know, everything from discovery all the way through to life cycle management. To me, there are three primary functions of an IT area in a pharma company. One is a mechanical function, in a sense, to make sure that systems talk to each other and interconnect, and that the systems work, and that they're constantly running at maximum efficiency. There's a certain set of skills and capabilities that are required to do that. A second function of IT in all of our groups, more and more, needs to be analytics. Understanding patterns in data, being able to capture those patterns in a timely way, so you're not looking in the rearview mirror 60 days, 100 days, whatever, but you're actually getting data that you can act on quickly, and then trying to interpret that data in ways that are meaningful for the business. So analytics is a separate function that typically falls under this IT umbrella. And then the third is how we think about applying new technology, like what I referenced a minute ago, in a system-wide approach. And so it's an innovation function almost. And, you know, as organizations in our industry, we typically just pile that all into the IT function. And we said, you know, look, the chief information officer is responsible for this. It's a shared service. You know, they support the line of business, et cetera, et cetera. And there really is, you know, we're really missing the opportunity to integrate IT into our business if we have this kind of mindset or framework around how we leverage the IT function. So think about that in your own organizations. Think about, you know, whether the model that's gotten us to here and how we apply IT will be sufficient to take us to the future that we just talked about. A second area is around R&D productivity. We started off with this a little bit. You know, there needs to be changes. There have to be changes in the way we do our discovery in pharmaceuticals and innovative pharmaceuticals in particular. There are emerging approaches that make a lot of sense, but are still not widely applied. Adaptive clinical trial design, for example, the idea to custom tailor design in a scientifically rigorous way to drive toward optimal results in the shortest period of time, shortest cost. You can see the impact that in this graphic on the left that adaptive clinical trial design can have. In some studies, it's projected to be an order of 25% reduction in cost of R&D. Yet we don't use this as a standard yet, although hopefully we will move there. And then also this idea of adoption of digital technology in clinical trials for patient tracking, et cetera, patient diaries, behavior influence, these kinds of things. And, you know, it's talked about a lot, but maybe some folks will have some examples to share where companies are really, you know, walking the talk. To my knowledge, I think there's only one company to date that actually has included a software app in the NDA for the approval of the product, and that's the Vertex cystic fibrosis product. It has a patient symptom monitor and a titration component. It's in the file. But you know, how long is it going to take for that to become more mainstream? What kinds of thinking needs to happen, and how do our scientific colleagues in the clinical area need to evolve in ways that allow technology that exists today to augment the effectiveness of the therapeutic in a clinically, scientifically rigorous way. A third area is around, and this is an important one. I assume most of the people in the room have a commercial background or some interaction on the commercial side of business. How we engage with customers and how we think about this triangle in the middle here of data, customer, and channel. As we move into the future more and more, traditional ways of understanding customer needs and customer trends and segments are no longer going to be significant. When I started in the industry, I was a sales representative, professional rep, we called them back then, and I think when I stopped in that function, at Merck, our selling organization had more than tripled, and I think we had some 10,000 people in the marketplace. We have around 3,000 today. So there's symptoms already of the fact that model that had served us well for so many years isn't the model that's going to take us into the future. And so, to me, what this means is not only do we need to get better at leveraging technology in the commercial space to make real-time decisions and to understand how to best employ the data that we have to an efficient outcome, but in a traditional sense, the marketing and sales silos that have typically lived somewhat independently are going to be forced together in this kind of model. And selling is going to be as much marketing as marketing is going to be selling. And so, you know, it kind of challenges to me the convention of a strategy commercial function and an execution commercial function when in real time execution is going to be occurring and strategic decisions need to be made in real time to supplement that. So something to think about from a commercial standpoint as you think about your own organization. And I think if you carry that further, this is a modern, very, very current depiction of something that we've worked with for years, a buying process, right? But the buying process now in the future is going to include data-driven, technology-enabled inputs at each phase of it and real-time adjustments in ways that reflect not only what customers need and want, what their preferences are, but changes in the marketplace, competitive changes, et cetera. So digitization, data, customer centricity, the interface between marketing and sales, all of those things, I think we need to kind of scratch our head and say, you know, are we doing this the right way, given the challenges, the opportunities and the challenges the future represents. A fifth area, which is pretty important and I think reasonably well recognized, although I'd argue is still a second tier in our world of science, is the area of real-world outcomes research, real-world clinical evidence. The ability to demonstrate the value therapies bring in a real-world setting, not in controlled clinical trials. You know, we all understand when we test our medicines, we test them in the most pristine environment one could hope for. We put all kinds of controls in place. We have standards that monitor every patient that intervene when there's any variation. We're able to track compliance. We're able to track response. We're able to track side effects. And then we report those results in the label of the product and then bring them to customers and say, you're going to get these same results. And the reality is, it's really hard to get those same results because they can't duplicate, in most cases, that pristine controlled environment that we study our products in. And there are very valid regulatory reasons for why we have to study our products that way. We all understand that. But the reality for our customers is they really can rarely be sure when they make a decision to buy a new therapy that they're going to get the advertised benefit that we talk about. And part of the reason for that is there are all these other factors that confound the outcome of the patient, which you talked about a little bit at the beginning. The more able we are to measure and understand these real-world evidence, real-world effectiveness results of our products, the more informed and sophisticated our dialogue can be with our customers, our payers, governments, etc. And so the emergence of technology, the investment in, from a capital allocation standpoint, capabilities, and even the culture within the company around the value of science in this area, to me seems like it's a very important area of focus for the industry going forward. A sixth area of focus, of opportunity that frankly I think you don't have to look too far to see that the model we've used to date isn't sustainable going forward is around our supply chain, around how we bring products to market. And this is just meant to, again, provoke thinking, but you know, readily available data, take a look at how we fare across some fairly common metrics of supply chain efficiency. We would be dead in a fast-moving consumer group products environment. You know, if our business dynamics mirrored most companies' business dynamics in terms of focus on capital, margin, et cetera, operating margin, et cetera, working capital, we would be out of business. Yet, you know, our dynamics, our underlying economics have allowed us to operate with these kinds of numbers for years. And the question is just now, as pricing pressure becomes more intense, as governments struggle to meet the needs of patients who demand access to healthcare, and that the number of those patients increases, as we talked about as a tailwind, this kind of inefficiency has to get wrong out of the system. And the companies that figure out how to do it first are going to have competitive advantage. There's no question when there's this, when there are these kinds of discrepancies. So many of the things that we talked about, by the way, will enable improvement here. The emerging technology that we talked about, focusing on different methods for manufacturing and distributing our products, models that balance the need to own versus the ability to outsource and flex, for example, and leverage some of the capacity across the industry. And then the last area is really related to global services and the shared services, the infrastructure, the back office stuff that we all wrestle with that is absolutely necessary to keep our companies running, but can, without a sharp eye, frequently take on a life of its own and become self-fulfilling. The need to build out to meet the need to continue to grow is disguised frequently under the sense of supporting the business, when a lot of times there are more efficient ways to provide these shared services. And if you look across your own company, and I know we've looked very carefully at this at Merck, and we made great progress on a lot of these things, but we still struggle. We're not nearly where we need to be yet. We aren't standard in the way we provide back office support. The support for our businesses across markets isn't really tied yet to the return we get on our business in individual markets. So, if you think about an individual business, an individual market, the cost structure of that business is supported by the economics of the business itself. And in many cases, we have cost structure that our business in that market doesn't support. I don't think that's unique to Merck, frankly. So looking for ways to centralize and standardize and validating that these ways can be scaled, driving across, these are hard discussions. How do you force the organization to change to more standard approaches that are cost effective? And then looking for additional ways to extract value from the infrastructure that we know we have to cost of doing business. Are there other ways of monetizing these kinds of fixed costs? So there's seven areas just summarized here on the slide to think about it. As the afternoon proceeds, hopefully some of these will come up in the panel discussions that are going to occur in a couple minutes, and there are probably others as well. But just in a kind of macro sense, I think these are some of the things that we have to challenge ourselves as an industry to take on as the environment continues to change. The good news is there's a lot of opportunity, and it's there for ours to take. And for the naysayers who say, big pharma and pharmaceutical industry isn't an attractive place to be anymore, there's no way that can be true. The human need behind what we're doing is overwhelming, and our ability to do what we do is unique. No one else can do this, and so we have a great future in front of us, but we also have a great responsibility to really challenge the way that we've traditionally operated. And if we're successful at doing that, the sky's the limit. So I'll stop there, and I guess we'll open a couple of questions.
Slide that there was 258 days of inventory.
Supply chain. The question is, why 258 days? And I'm looking at that saying, wouldn't a financial guy drill into that really, really hard? So what's the driving force to have 9 months worth of inventory?
I think I'll give you my opinion on it. Obviously, that's all I'm able to do. But I think to me, there's a couple things that come into that. One is, traditionally, the connection between, and this is not unique to pharma, by the way, it's common across a lot of industries that are focusing on working capital and trying to understand, why they have these inefficiencies. And you're right, that's one of the first places you go. But there's a disconnect between the ability to forecast from a demand standpoint in the commercial organizations of most companies and the supply forecasts. And if you deconstruct that, it's not a surprise, right? Sales organizations are incented to meet or achieve their objectives. So they tend to forecast in a way that helps to, helps the likelihood that upside occurs. Let's just say it that way. On the other hand,
sandbag.
Yeah, thank you. On the other hand, you know, now it's virtually, it's almost the exact opposite on the manufacturing side, right? You know, manufacturing organizations are siloed again, right? Siloed organizations are frequently, most often, incented by utilization efficiency. So output from the plants. You know, if the plants are running at close to or max capacity, it's a good day. Ratings are higher, right? So you've got plants that have incentive to produce. You've got sales that have the incentive to underestimate forecasts, and then you end up having these gaps in inventory accumulates. I think that's one reason. I think another reason, frankly, is because of the margins in our business, it costs a lot more to stock out than it does to destroy inventory. And, you know, because you're talking about pennies on the dollar frequently. And so stocking out is dollar on the dollar. Destruction of excess inventory or discards is pennies on the dollar. And so there's an incentive to err on the side of oversupply. And I think we're seeing some of that. And that's not, you know, that's a reasonable, you know, that's a reasonable calculation. I think the issue is we've gotten kind of out of the zone, right? And so the question is, how many days can you come down, still feel confident that you're not going to hit a stockout situation, you've got the right kind of safety barriers, or you've got alternate supply plans in place if you need them, and realize the value of taking that inventory out of the system. Other questions?
I have a question about the market shift. Earlier, about 20 years back, it was seen that the European market was more or less equivalent to the US market. But now, most of the pharma companies, even the leading ones, the R&D spending is coming out of the US. Does that affect the overall growth?
In terms of the percent of spending that's centered on the US?
Yes. Innovation as well as the R&D spending.
That's a good question. I mean, my instinctive response is if for some reason the environment, the attractiveness, the incentives in the U.S. were to materially shift, I would think that it would have a significant impact on the ability to spend. I mean, that might be a question to get, you know, to get from more input from across the panels or just within the group, but. You know, the fact that the economics are so attractive in the U.S. market is, you know, probably not disconnected with the fact that most of the R&D activity and spending occurs. So I think that's important. I mean, it starts to get into the political realm, and some of these debates are happening now. But you know, certainly pharma, I think, has made the point that you know, the value creation opportunities in the U.S. market provide an important engine for the world's innovation.
Could you please comment around these data companies that have great relationships with consumers like Google and others that now look at the healthcare space as really interesting?
Yeah, it's a great question. And it's interesting. Virtually all, so it's not just the consumer really, it's the tech industry, Silicon Valley. These folks are all dying to get into healthcare. You know, Apple will tell you, I was just at Apple in December. And Tim Cook himself, who was in the meeting I was in, will tell you healthcare is a major strategic goal for Apple. Qualcomm's a sleeper. A lot of people don't appreciate Qualcomm was smart enough to kind of let Intel have the laptops and make the brains for the smartphones, which they do today. They've got a whole healthcare division, right? Google Lifesciences. They the engineering lens that the tech community brings to healthcare. Seems logical, right? You've got a lot of inconsistency, a lot of discrepancy between evidence and practice. You know, there are interconnectivity challenges, there are massive data sets to manage. And these people have the capability doing that, so they do every day. The piece that's going to be a challenge, and it's not a permanent challenge, it's a temporary challenge, is around scientific validation, I think. I think that, you know, the tech industry is still missing the point that in healthcare, it's not like technology. Technology, a new idea, a new device, a new chip, something comes out, and everybody jumps on it. And they want to use it right away, and they just automatically accept that it's a step forward because of the laws, et cetera, right? In healthcare, it actually doesn't happen that way. As you guys know, it takes years to establish clinical validation and scientific acceptance. And there's rigorous protocols, there's rigorous processes that need to be followed. Patient safety is paramount, and the general lens is skepticism of new technology, not the embracing of it. And so I think, you know, the tech people still haven't figured this out yet, the Googles of the world, and we do a lot of work with these folks. One of the jobs I have is to manage our venture fund. Bob mentioned it briefly, so we do a lot of work with these tech companies. But they're going to, right? So they haven't yet, but they're going to. They're going to figure out at some point how to gain that credibility within the medical and healthcare world. Personally, I think the opportunity is enormous. You know, if a contact lens that measures glucose levels, not, you know, once a day or twice a day or 10 times a day, but all day, continuously, 24/7, and beams that data to a phone that beams it to a cloud, for an individual person multiplied by millions of people, you know, and Google will tell you, as they told us, they can manage that data today. Real-time streaming data from millions of people into the cloud. They can manage that data, and they can analyze it, and they can discover things that we can only begin to dream about, you know, what that data will tell us. So tremendous opportunity, but so far, the need to include pharma in the process, and I think that's, you know, that's what it does. Where we're going to see the focus. Other thoughts, questions? One more? Okay.
Thanks. I'm not asking you to look into a crystal ball, but I'd love to hear your take on this. So this has been an interesting election cycle, and we're seeing all sides demonize the pharmaceutical industry once again. I'm just curious, how do you foresee this impacting our industry? Do you have a sense of where this is going?
I do, you know, but it's worth about what you're paying for, which is, you know, it's an opinion. But I think there are a couple of things playing in. The short answer, I'll talk about this. The short answer to me is, to me, the message is, you guys that are responsible for this industry, all of us, you need to be responsible about how you're running your businesses, right? Society needs you, but there's an accountability that comes with that says you know you can't be lazy, you can't lay back, you can't overlook things that other industries can't overlook. Those glory days are gone. You can't afford that anymore. And that to me is the takeaway, regardless of who wins. It's just a wake up call, another wake up call that says we've got to kind of raise the bar in how we, as an industry, think about our businesses, what we come to expect from the way we run our businesses, how we have to constantly innovate to improve efficiency. You know, many businesses take an annual objective that says you're going to improve operating efficiency every year by X amount. It's just built in. You know, we do it in our industry. We do it when there's some need to cut costs because of big products going off patent, you know, for example. So I think that's the big takeaway. I think the political rhetoric, you know, some of these smaller things that are going on, we're a soft target as an industry. Not many people understand, and there are lots of reasons for that. The way we price our products is really obscure and complicated, and many people don't understand where science comes from, where new therapeutics come from. Most people, I think, if you survey, you know, I read something a week or two ago that most people think that the NIH discovers all the new drugs that we get, and you know, and universities and these kinds of things. And so there's just a lot of ignorance really around how what the role of pharmaceutical plays and how the pharmaceutical industry plays and how that works. And so we're a soft target as a result. And you know, we're gonna take our blows. I think the bigger, you know, when push comes to shove, you know, society wants a cure for Zika. They want a cure for Ebola. They want a cure for hepatitis. They want new medicines that you don't die if you get certain diagnoses of cancer or other diseases, right? And when you take the conversation to that level, there's really not a lot of debate about the value the industry brings. It's this other stuff, you know, how we do it, that folks don't really understand. Great. So maybe, if there aren't any more questions, maybe we should move to the panel. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff.